Welcome back. You're still watching Morning Live. Now, Cenotaph of Dan Moriri is a reconstruction of Tony Miyambo's memories of his father and his death, with an intimate father-son relationship played out through remembered moments of the past. The one-act play production is a journey about loss and how Tony then felt with the death of his father. Played by Tony himself, the play opened on Friday at the Market Theatre in Johannesburg. And he joins us now to tell us more about this unique production. Tony, good morning. Welcome to Morning Live.
Good morning. Thank you for having me.
Tell us a little bit about this production. I mentioned it a little bit in the intro, but tell us in your own words what this production is about.
Well, this is a personal biography, obviously about my dad, but it's about love, it's about adolescence, it's about memory, and it's a way of creating a living monument to a man that simply moved my life in so many ways. So it's been an absolute pleasure to be able to tell the story at the Market Theatre.
Why was it important for you to tell the story?
I think, you know, as artists, we're sort of drawn to sometimes always wanting to tell the big narratives. But for me, there's something that fundamentally shifted in me with my father's passing. And I was there was a discomfort about how quickly things moved on. It was like we took 7 days and we prepared and we put them in the ground and the world moved on.
Yeah.
And so that was the starting point, really, of the idea of the play. And I felt that, you know, we need to be able to honor the ordinary, everyday people that move us in particular ways. And this was, for me, something that I felt strongly about, and I also got an opportunity to do, so why not do it?
The significance of the title, tell us a little bit about how you came up with that.
Well, my partner, my co-creator William Harding, actually came up with the idea of the Cenotaph. My father's had always been referred to as Dan Moriri because he was a hairstylist, and the idea of a cenotaph is about a living monument, but the physical bodies are no longer there. So a lot of the World War memorials are cenotaphs. So the idea of the cenotaph came from a particular theme in the play, which I don't want to give away. But the idea of a monument that's moving, that's recreated over and over, and that's what we do every time we perform this play.
Talk to us about the journey of putting this production together. You have your own memories, but then also you must consider how the audience is going to respond to that. Take us through that.
Well, it really started with my time at Wits University. I was struggling with a piece that I wanted to create about my dad while I was studying. I got the opportunity to work with Gerard Bester, the director, was then my lecturer at the time, and sort of we grappled with the piece in a mini version that wasn't the Cenotaph at the time. And then in 2014, I got the opportunity to create a piece for the inaugural Soul Solo Festival at the Wits Festival, Wits Theatres, and then the Cenotaph came about. And really, the process of creating the play was a series of recorded sessions that we transcribed, and then we started then to really edit it. And we brought on William Harding, who's a brilliant theatre maker, to come help us make sense of all these different memories that we had transcribed, so we could put it into the shape that the play exists in today.
You're quoted as saying that this was a difficult process, but also rewarding. Tell us a little bit about that.
Yes, it was. It was a difficult process because one of the things I took for granted when I thought, when thinking about my father, is that I'd always remember things, you know. So that was really the beginning point of the play, was the frustration of not remembering things. Like, all of a sudden I couldn't remember the tone of his voice, or I couldn't remember exactly how tall he was or exactly how crooked his smile was, and that became a huge obsession and a frustration for me. And then it created itself as one of the biggest themes: how do we remember? So you have this figure who's in a bare space, who's just trying to place things, and it was here and then it moved and it was there, and then all of a sudden it comes back. And, you know, so a memory is an elusive thing, but it's also quite a dynamic thing. So it's been exciting to remember certain things, to place certain things, to use certain things to create this image of this man. But it's also been very difficult because some of the things you lose and you can't quite hold on to. So it's been a real journey to try and make sense of, you know, his place in my life and the different ways in which I choose to remember him.
How important was you to consult the family members, you know, other family members? Because, you know, you'd get that art that says, yeah, your dad has to do that. Do you know what I mean?
It was a very selfish endeavor for me because of some of the difficulties within the family. Talking about my father was also quite a difficult thing for the family.
Yeah.
So in a way, this process existed outside of that. And it was really for me. It was a selfish endeavor. And I thought at the beginning, you know, nobody's going to understand this as a body of work, as a play. And I've been pleasantly surprised at how it's opened up since audiences have come to watch it. I mean, my mother and my sisters came to watch it for the first time on Friday.
Yeah.
After 2 years of me working and grappling with it, and they're just happy that in some way I am choosing to remember this man who you know, who was in our lives and left. But they've been very supportive, and it's also been very hard for them, but you know, I appreciate the fact that they understand why it is that I needed to do it.
And those memories, how much of it is in the production, the memories that you have? And you know, we don't always have good memories of people, but it's also important that we see both sides of this person.
It's all in there.
It's
all in there, and that's the heart of what the work is. It's you know, remembering, you know, the bad moments, remembering the good moments, but also remembering the love, remembering the adolescence, remembering the innocence. So the play is really a mixture of things that culminated in one moment. So it's not all about grief, and it's certainly not all about my father. It's also about me trying to make sense of who I am in relation to a particular time and place.
Yeah. How many of those of your own questions are being answered in the production? As a child, that is.
I think fundamentally all the questions I had going into the process have been answered.
Mm-hmm.
There's a lot of material which we also took out after we made the play and we realized it doesn't actually work.
Yeah.
It creates other questions which don't belong in the work. So we've tried not to labor the work, but for me, the play is one big answer, you know, and every time I perform it, I'd like to think I'm having a conversation with my father in some way. And I'm allowing people who didn't know him to have a conversation with him and to learn more about him.
What do you want your audience to take away from this production?
That the ordinary is important,
mm-hmm.
and that we need to appreciate each and every single moment that we have with our loved ones, and that it's also okay to remember them and place them after they've passed. And that, you know, growing up and loving for the first time and being a teenager is part of a process, but that we should always try to keep our eyes on what it is that matters. And for me, that's the relationships that we have with people that we love.
So Friday was opening night. How was that for you?
It was surreal.
Yeah.
I mean, this is my first time at the Market Theatre. You study at WITS, you're just across from the Market Theatre, and all you dream about is performing on that stage, and I get to perform a play about my father. I cannot even begin to express how much it's meant to me, for me to have the support of the Market Theatre, of the audiences. And also, we had a standing ovation. I don't know how much that means in these days, but you know, people were really moved by the piece, and people were really moved by the story. And for me, it's just been amazing to see the support that people are giving the play, a play that I initially thought was a selfish endeavor to try, you know, psychologize myself, if that's even a word. But I've been pleasantly surprised at how people are receiving the work.
Is it because so many of us can relate to being growing up with no father?
Absolutely. And also, many of us can relate to the idea of loss. Many of us can relate to the idea of first love, of memory. So these are themes that people are easily able to access and attach onto. And people don't necessarily need to know my father to know the importance of what it means to be able to remember people in a particular way. And I think that's what's really been the draw card for people. And also how we stage the play. The play is itself it's staged in a way that speaks in the form. It speaks to the idea of fading memory. We use hundreds of tiny little wooden blocks to evoke different images on stage. And it's really a play that requires quite a healthy imagination. But when you're there, it opens up your world to different stages in my life, but that also take a physical form in some way on the stage.
All right, talk to us about the rest of the team. You know, how important was the, you know, to have this amazing lighting guy, you know, so that it comes across nicely, you know, on the stage, and it's proper. Yeah,
I've been really blessed. I want to talk about my producer, Gita Patha, first of all, who's a very important woman in the theatre-making space, because she gave an opportunity to a young man who had never, who didn't have opportunities at that time, by producing the work for the Soul Solo Festival. Gerard Bester, who's just so delicate, and so he just understands biographical work so intimately, and he's gentle and understands how to work with people's stories without encroaching on what those stories need to become, you know, very vulnerable as a person himself. And it's been great to be vulnerable with somebody in a space and let that become something at the end of the day. William Harding, which I mentioned, he's a fantastic theatre maker who came in to make sense of the mess that Gerard and I created at some point. And Julian Bester, whose lighting design is just so delicate and considered, and without, I think without the lights, the show wouldn't be what it is, because what it does is that it gives another layer to the meaning that we're creating, and this idea of the fading memory, creating spaces that then dissolve themselves and move on into. It's like memory. It's how you remember things. It's almost like a symphony, the way in which he lights that stage is been amazing. But also, you know, the way he just cries after every show.
Yeah,
but he's trying to run the lights is really precious.
All right.
I've really enjoyed that support.
Tony, thank you so much for talking to us. Interesting conversation that Tony Miyambo talking to us about the Cenotaph of Dan Moriri, currently taking place at the Market Theatre in Johannesburg. Interesting conversation. It's a production about his dad. All